I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. You may be seated. First on our program this evening is a work set. Well, we had a work session at 6 o'clock, and council in that session discussed how we are going to proceed with filling a vacancy on council. We have three public hearings this evening. Council's intention to adopt an ordinance vacating a 50-foot public utility easement interior to the rear property line at 645 Southview Terrace. That's tax parcel 528-9-52.
Is that a 10-foot parcel?
10-foot.
Only 10-foot.
10-foot.
10-foot easement.
It's a 10-foot. Did I say?
50.
Did I? It's 10-foot. I'll get my eyes checked this week. Is there anyone here that would like to speak to this intention, this public hearing? Yes, sir.
I would, Mr. Ballard.
If you'll stand and state your name.
I'm Jay Dickerson. I'm the property owner of this property here. And I hate being kind of embarrassed to even talk to you about this, but back 4 or 5 years ago, I decided to build a pole building, had a contractor come in and build it. And when they did, we called the town up and asked them what we needed to do. Don't know who we talked to. Town said, make sure you're 3 foot off the property line. There's no inspections on it. It's a pole building. Proceed on. We did. Got the building built. I don't remember exactly when. One evening I was home, Mr. Wingfield come by. He got a complaint that I was running Janelle paving out of my house. Well, I had Jake pave my driveway about 2 years before this, and Randy came by and checked it out and didn't find anything. About 2 hours later, Randy called me back and he said, we got a problem. He said, you gotta have a permit for that building out back. Well, we contacted the general contractor out of Floyd that built the building. He came up, met with Jerry and them, and they worked on it, and came to find out there's an easement through there for the right-of-way. Well, Randy says, Mr. Wingfield says, I'm incorrect. I thought he was going to get with Barry about it, and it was taken care of. I didn't hear anything. I hired another contractor to put me an in-ground pool in, and when I did, the town stopped me on my pool and said I can't do my pool because the issue hadn't been vacated. Town was nice enough to work with us and got the pool permit taken care of and everything. So now we've applied for the right-of-way. APCO has one street light that joins the neighbors on the side, and now Mr. Wingfield's telling me that APCO's objecting to this thing. The problem with APCO objecting to the thing is there's an oak on my property that's probably 48 inches round that has an electric wire running through it that's rubbing the electric line, and you call APCO and ask them to come out and fix this so my son don't get electrocuted. They come out and put a sleeve on it and leave it there. You know, they won't fix it, but they won't vacate the right or the easement through this thing. Now, I've already got a building that I spent $25,000 for, and APCO's the one that's objecting to this whole hearing, but they're not here tonight. You know, all the neighbors are here to can tell you what we've done to the neighborhood and how hard we've worked to make the neighborhood what it is, and to help the town out. And I just don't, even worse than that, the county backed up and billed me $1,200 in back taxes on the building that's in place already. I paid them today, here's the receipts. The town backed up and billed me on the town taxes for the building. So I paid taxes on the building for 11, 12, and 13. But I understand that APCO's objecting to this being vacated. I don't understand how APCO can control a piece of property and how the county can tax me on this, and now this building looks like I may have to tear it down. You know, we work hard for our money and we do a good job, and we contacted the proper channels for this thing, and now we're going to let APCO dictate this thing because they've got one night light that shines on the neighbor's property on the thing, and APCO don't want to vacate the right of way. Their power lines are above their head. They don't even go over the building. But APCO's objecting to this? I don't understand.
All right. Well, thank you, Mr. Dickerson. Can you add anything?
Yes, sir. I have a letter I got this afternoon from APCO. They have two easements themselves across the property before the public utility easement, the way I understand it. But they object. Let me just read it to you. In reference to inquiry concerning an easement granted Appalachian Electric Power Company predecessor entitled to Appalachian Power Company from W.J. Flagg, Betty Stewart Goldsmith, and E.L. Goldsmith, dated December 21st, 1953, recorded in Clerk's Office, Montgomery County, and has a deed book. Also, easement granted Appalachian Power Company from K.T. Williams and Helen V. Williams, dated February 5th, 1988, recorded in Clerk's Office. This grant is also covered by public utility easement as conveyed on a plat titled Map of Oakwood Subdivision Number 1, dated August 1952, located east of Christopher Corporate Limits and South Highway Number 11. This easement area has future use, is currently in use, and cannot be released. Therefore, AEP objects to vacating said 10-foot easement for public utilities as shown on the plat. I think we could still vacate the 10-foot easement, but that doesn't get rid of Appalachian's easements. Well, read this. They have two easements separate from the public utility easement that we have, or that's on, not necessarily us, but us and all other public utilities.
Mr. Valenti, I'm not asking, I mean, I understand the political side of vacating the easement as far as the town's concerned. APCO, the cable, and everybody that has an easement through there can keep their easement. Their lines aren't affecting me any at all. The building's already built. Their lines are still in place. The APCOs are in place. If they need an easement in front of the building, I'll give them whatever they want. All I want is to be able to leave my building there. I mean, you know, it was built, it was done, and you can't undo it unless you tear it down.
Have you conveyed that to APCO?
I didn't know until Mr. Wingfield just come up here a minute ago and told me that. But you know how APCO is. I mean, how's a little guy go against APCO? And he's saying, from what Barry's saying, APCO has a separate easement besides the easement that the town has. Is that correct, Mr. Hamilton?
The way I read this is it goes over basically the same spot as our easement.
So even if the town vacates their easement that they have, that dead ends on my lot and don't go through Mr. Butterfield's or Mr. Hammer's or Ms. Showalter's, it's a dead end easement. APCO still will have their easement when this is all said and done. Is that correct?
That's the way I interpret what they stated on here is correct. They still have two easements that affect your property, and that's not what we're talking about vacating.
So, I mean, that's good.
They could be in the same place, and I interpret as they're in the same place, but they're not. If we vacate ours, there's still an easement there for AEP.
Mm-hmm. How long have you had that building there?
Mr. Hubbard, I guess somewhere between 3 and 4 years. And when the county, when this thing started back 2 or 3 years ago, between me and Mr. Wingfield back and forth, I thought the process was one way and it ended up being another way. And they told me I need to come in and apply to vacate the easement, and that's what we did. And then the county assessor came by a few weeks ago or a month ago, and then Mr. Henline called me and said, hey, they're here on this thing. The county sent me out tax bills for right at $1,200 on the building that was there. Then the town, not only the town, we was applying for an electrical permit on the swimming pool. The most embarrassing thing ever, I get a call from the town and says, through the electrical contractor, and says, you can't get your permit. You have delinquent taxes. Well, I'm 47 years old and I've never been delinquent. But they had stopped my permit until I had stopped right in the middle of what I was doing, pulled a credit card out, and paid the town $740 in taxes for the building that's existing that we're asking to vacate the right-of-way on. I mean, and it's not the town, it's the county and the way they're running this process. I just don't get the whole point. The easement's a dead end. It doesn't go all the way to the end of the street. It's 10 feet wide. You've got four lots after me that, when you get to my lot, it's a dead end. There's no way to proceed any further with it, with water, sewer, cable, electric, or anything. It stops there, so I don't know what they could ever do with it. But I'll leave APCO, and it sounds like I don't have a choice in leaving APCO, but I'll leave APCO, the town, and everybody can put what they want through it. I just don't want to tear my building down.
Is there anyone else who would like to speak to this request?
Yeah, I'm Alan Butterfield. I live next door to Jay at 675. I have no objection to vacating the easement.
I'm Billy Barrow. I live across the street from Jay. When he first moved in, the house really looked bad, and he's made so many improvements on it. It's really makes the neighborhood really good. And I thank the town for going along with you.
All right, thank you, sir. Anyone else?
I'm Alfred Tickle. I live across the street from Jay, and he has been a very good neighbor and has improved the neighborhood considerably with his house improvements and improvements to his property. And I could see no reason why anyone would want to maintain an easement that goes nowhere. Now, we have roads that go nowhere, bridges that go nowhere, but I think that this is the first of an easement that goes nowhere that I know of, and I certainly would recommend abandon this thing.
Anyone else? Is vacating this easement going to give Mr. Dickerson relief? Or is he still going to have to deal with APCO?
He's still have to deal with APCO.
All right.
I don't mind dealing with APCO. If the town vacates the easement, then that leaves the building, correct? Unless... Yeah, mm-hmm. If the town will approve the building, I'll be happy to deal with APCO. Because when APCO can leave a tree and put a rubber band around a light pole and it's still there, if anybody'd like to look at it, and you worry about your four-year-old getting electrocuted, and they tell you this is the best they can do, but they don't want to move a light, I'll be happy to deal with APCO. Mm-hmm.
All right.
Thank y'all.
Thank you. There's no one else to speak to this ordinance. We'll close that public hearing. Go to number two, which is council's intention to adopt an ordinance amending chapter 30 zoning, specifically sections 30-185, 30-186, 30-190, and 30-193 of the Christiansburg Town Code. This will clarify the requirements for final site plans when preliminary and final site plans expire, the fees associated with the submittal of the same. Mr. Helms, would you explain that further?
Well, one thing I want to bring up is with a recodification last meeting, these numbers changed to chapter 42, section 625, 626, 630, and 633, and the ordinance that was in the packet is proper, it has those proper numbers on it. I missed that on that.
Right, is there anyone here this evening that would speak to this intention to adopt this ordinance? If not, then we will close this public hearing. Move to number three, which is council's intention to adopt an ordinance requesting the General Assembly consideration of an amendment to the Christiansburg Town Charter. Is there anyone here that would like to speak to this public hearing? Seeing none, we'll close this public hearing and move into council business. Christiansburg Town Council is now officially opened. You have a copy of the minutes of the last meeting, and I assume you've had an opportunity to read those. Are there any corrections or additions to the minutes?
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion and a second to approve the minutes of the last meeting. Discussion. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. The minutes are approved. This evening, we have with us our Executive Director of Tourism, Ms. Lisa Blakely, who will update council on tourism activities. Lisa?
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of council. It was this week last year that we held the first meeting to determine the direction of a new tourism program. Thank you for your support during that process, for approving our plan, and for your continued support as we began to build the program. You'll find before you a handout, a one-sheet handout, with the five goals from the plan that are noted on that sheet. As the goals are considered, you may think, okay, well, these are pretty admirable goals, and okay, they may even be successful or an indicator of success for the program, but what is the bottom line? Well, my primary reasons for speaking with you tonight are to ensure that the tourism's bottom line remains forefront of your mind, share the progress of the program with you, and then to show how that progress relates to the town of Christiansburg, since the tourism program does work for the town of Christiansburg, Blacksburg, and the county. The amount of visitor travel expenditures was right at $1.3 million for 2012. Montgomery County, countywide, realized an increase of 6.3% in travel expenditures. What that means is visitors left $762,287 more dollars in 2012 here in our community than they left in 2011. True, there were some increases in both meals and occupancy tax, but that would only account for a fraction of that increase in travel expenditures. In talking with the state tourism office, we can attribute the increase to several different things, but generally, a change in people's lifestyle, that would be urban dwellers maybe would be an example of coming from city centers looking for authentic and wholesome experiences. We're positioned very nicely for that. Drive-in travel tends to hold during economic ups and downs. Friends and family continue to drive visitation. I know over the holiday I had a lot of family in from Florida and Georgia, and while you would think that they would stay in my house, all did not. They stayed in hotel rooms and contributed to our occupancy tax increase there. Consumers continue to look for value in their travel, and we're positioned very nicely statewide and here locally for that as well. The tourism office has begun to process tracking metrics, and these metrics would include the number of groups that we have coming in, whether they be swim meets at the aquatic center and their number of registrants, or tournaments, sporting tournaments and their number of registrants, occupancy in hotels, that's another metric that we would look at. And this helps us gain insight into fluctuations in visitation and spending, and also to determine what our need periods are. And that's the capacity that we have in our community to accommodate more visitors. The catalyst for this was when I applied for the marketing leverage grants through the State Tourism Office. I submitted that in October, so keep your fingers crossed that later this month we'll hear that we were awarded that grant. BTC, or the State Tourism Office, has been a great resource for us as we build the program. We have benefited very much from state research, from state-funded tourism research. The Tourism Office hired a company recently to identify tourism growth opportunities around the state and here locally. Helpful indicators were discovered for our region, and I'd like to share a few of those with you tonight. And as I do, think about those possible reasons that I just recited and draw your own conclusions. So some of the things that they found out were that the primary purpose for trips to our region 50% of those people traveling to our region were to visit friends and family. It increases to 59% when you think about overall reasons for visiting the area. Outdoor recreation and entertainment, sightseeing comes in at number two. And then when you consider that we have six of the 25 most frequented attractions in the state, in our area, you really start to realize where this visitation comes from. We have the Blue Ridge Parkway, the Appalachian Trail, the Crooked Road, all right around us. How do they get here? Well, 80% uses a private auto to get to the area. They stay, 53% stay in a hotel and B&B versus 32% in a private home. They stay 25%, a quarter stays two nights, at least two nights. Lodging expenditures comes in third behind gasoline and dining. That's what they spend their money on while they're here. And then half have an annual household income of $60,000 or more. And how do they plan for their trip? Well, this is one of the most staggering pieces of information that I read in this whole profile. 61% of those that use offline sources, that is, other than websites and TripAdvisor and that sort of thing, they rely on information from their friends and their relatives as to where they're going to go. And so think about it, with two major universities here in our back door, and the interstate I-81, 460, and daily the traffic there, what we can do to make ambassadors out of those folks. 31% of those using online sources, they do depend on travel-related websites and are increasingly shifting more towards mobile. So in turning your attention back to the handout, the tactics or the actions currently being taken by the tourism office directly correlates to what we know about our visitors and also about our destination. They are actions we have identified and are currently working on to take advantage of having the knowledge of what our visitors are looking for, how they learn about us, and then how our destination is positioned to deliver on expectations. I will not go over everyone on the list. I'll leave that with you for your reference, but I do want to highlight just a few that may be of particular interest to you in Christiansburg. Under Goal 1, we talk about sponsorships. Over the last year, the Tourism Office has sponsored a number of events, including the Food Truck Rodeo, the Wilderness Trail Festival, just to name a few. This upcoming year, we're looking at sponsoring possibly some of the reoccurring events, but also looking at some new ones. There's a 2014 Motorcycle Grand Tour of Virginia. That's a statewide promoted tour. And we're looking at sponsoring that to the tune of $750. And what that will do, that will get our destination on this route of motorcyclists who have high disposable income and come through our area, a lot of them anyway, but withdraw in other areas of the state, hopefully. So looking at sponsoring that,
Ms. Whitney, can I ask you one question about that?
Yes.
When I was reading about some of the programs and talking just specifically to motorcyclists, which are great number, more than people realize, I believe. There was something I was discussing with members of the, a couple of motorcycles were coming through the area, that they have a point system, that if there's a particular local business that buys in, either through the, I don't know if it's through tourism or through the county, I guess really through tourism, that they can get a point system, and by staying at a particular night in a locality, maybe it's a bed and breakfast, maybe it's a hotel, maybe going to a certain eatery, that they can accumulate these points, and at the end of the year, these points, I guess they can be attributed to something else. I don't know how the process works, but is this an, do you have any insight upon that? Because it seemed like that was a pretty good idea as well.
You just described the way this particular event works.
Okay.
And it is promoted by the State Motorcycle Dealers Association. And the way it does work on a point system. And right now they're in the process of collecting sponsors, whether it be a bed and breakfast or a restaurant or a visitor information center. And there is a point system. And a visitor information center would carry more points if they visit that, with the thought being that we would be able to provide more information to have them visit even more places than maybe would even be on the sponsorship list. And then there's a grand prize that is awarded at the end of the year, which
Harley-Davidson, isn't it, I believe, it, aren't they involved with that, the final prize?
Yes, the Harley Owners Group, I believe, is involved with that final prize. So it's a pretty good deal, and it's thousands. I have the stats back in my office on the event that they ran last year, and it looks to be pretty promising for this year as well. So thank you for allowing me.
I didn't mean to interrupt. I didn't realize you were going to talk about that.
No, that's great. And there have been several, a couple actually, of Christiansburg located businesses that are interested in this as well, who actually brought this to my attention. So the Oaks Victorian B&B is one of those. Okay, so that's an example of goal one. Goal two, you'll see a bullet point assessing motor coach capability. I just wanted to elaborate that right now we have a number of motor coaches coming by on the interstate going from somewhere to somewhere else. And whether they stop or whether they don't is anybody's guess right now. I suspect that with the exit 118 is positioned very well to accept motor coaches. But what I'm looking at with this bullet point is, should the motor coach market segment be one that we go after intentionally? So I am in the process of sending out surveys and collecting more research from our hotels, restaurants, and so forth on the infrastructure. Under group three, I did want to point out that in cooperation with the Christiansburg Aquatic Center and the Christiansburg Parks and Rec Department, we met and provided a group business information session for the hospitality industry back in October. And we had a number of people show up for that. I think it was very well received. In addition to looking forward to holding that maybe annually, we're looking for additional ways to work together as well with the hospitality industry to help cross-promote, to help keep each other aware of activity in the area and so forth. So that will prove to be a very good partnership, I think. The 2014 Crooked Road Festival, I'm in the throes of planning that now with several other organizations, and how that would interest you is one, two actually, of the locations that we're looking at to house performances for that festival. It's in March 20th through 22nd. One is in the Montgomery Museum, and then the other, we are looking at potential venues for downtown Christiansburg. And I have been speaking with Pastor Height with the Main Street Baptist Church that now houses the daycare, but the sanctuary is empty and available, and they're willing to talk with us. So I'm pretty excited about that. And that's really all. Oh, no, one more thing. The Trans-American Bicycle Route, who's familiar with that? We are rediscovering that route. I say we, myself, and the other destination marketing organizations in the New River Valley, Giles, Pulaski, especially Giles and Pulaski. And I found out that in June 2014, there's an event that will bring cyclists cross country, and they'll come right through our area, right through downtown Christiansburg, as part of the inaugural Trans-America Ride of 2014. So we are all meeting together in determining how to best take advantage of that opportunity as well, and just more opportunities to highlight that very beneficial thing that we have in our own backyard. So.
Is that Route 76? Is that the Bicentennial?
Yes.
Right, yeah. It comes up Ellet Valley?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's been there a number of years, and I know some boys who have rode the whole thing.
That's right.
I have a question for you, too. You know, at first I thought that you were going to try to generate activities in Christiansburg, like during in the summer. I'm really interested in that. And like the food rodeo that we had last fall, how well received that was. But I think, are you more really a person who's sort of a middle person, and somebody comes to you and says, hey, I'm thinking about doing this. Can you give me some help maybe on financing or information or things like that? Is that your bailiwick, and has anybody maybe come to you, and or are you trying to work on generating things so that people know that you can do this?
Well, it behooves the tourism office to have those types of activities in our area. And there's a couple ways of looking at it. You could have an event that is of the significance that it would draw out-of-market folks into our area, like huge marathons and things of that nature that have been entrenched over years. There's also events that are more community-oriented, Not that that is not important to a visitor, because it, while it may not be the primary draw to get them into the area, it adds excitement, it adds activity while they're here for maybe another reason. So it's very important to the tourism office to have those activities. Having said that, this tourism office is not staffed at this point to get into the actual design and production of those types of events. It would be my hope that one day, maybe we could have greater input into that. But for now, the way I'm handling it is out of the tourism budget to allocate a certain amount that I'm able to use to sponsor organizations that are already producing events and to help them along. I'm also able to connect interested organizations with resources, whether it be through the State Tourism Office or the Virginia Arts Commission or a number of other places that I come across potential funding opportunities for those types of activities. So I am very much interested in discussing with any interested organizations or individuals to ramp that activity up. But I have not been directly contacted other than the ones I've mentioned, the events that I've sponsored in the past.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other questions, Council?
Well, I'm happy to answer any questions or talk with you later in detail at any point in time. And again, thank you so much for your support with this very vital part of our economic development.
Thank you, Lisa. Lisa has spent unmeasurable hours working on the tourism development here in Montgomery County, and she presented just recently at a Chamber of Commerce-sponsored event where she actually told us some of the monies that had come into Montgomery. I can't remember the total, but it was in the millions of tourism money that has come into the county. So thank you very much, Lisa.
And you know, we appreciate you coming by here, you know, every 6 months or every 8 months. I think I think everybody on council appreciates that. So we have an idea of what's going on and update and all that. That's very helpful. Thank
absolutely.
You.
Absolutely. I'll be happy for that opportunity.
Thank all right, you. Just whenever you want. I think you just talk to give Barry a call.
Thank you.
We have with us this evening an old friend that I'd like to introduce. I'm told he can't introduce his boss, but we'd like to introduce Tom Rutledge, who is project manager for Shaw Construction and Development, and we're anxious to hear what you have to say, Tom.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor and council members. Tom Rutledge from Shaw Development. Thank you for your time this evening. Couple things, I guess, to start with. I'm on the agenda tonight for a subdivision plat. It's a re-subdivision plat, item number 3 of Cambria Crossing Phase 1. To start with, we are very, very proud of that development. I think we're more proud that we weathered 2009 and 2010 and still have the development. But part of the plat and part of the reason I'm here tonight, Mr. Helms approached Mr. Hagan probably pushing 2 years ago, when I think everybody but Councilman Showalter and Councilman Hall, in some facet, whether it was town council or the planning commission, we went through a 6-month process of getting the old pumpkin patch rezoned. One of the key factors in it was there was this, hypothetical road that connected Pepper's Ferry and North Franklin Street. There was no funding for the road, there was no right-of-way acquisition, no design, no anything. There was just a few lines drawn on the map. Well, we were going through the rezoning process, and Mr. Hagan and Mr. Sheeler and myself felt very firmly that we wanted to build a community at Cambria Crossing, and this road actually divided it. It's right through the center of the property. So we kind of put the rezoning on hold, went back to council, went back to VDOT, planning commission, everything, and we actually were able to relocate the right-of-way for this road to parallel with the railroad line, which allowed us to build a community. And one that we're all very proud of. I think it's beautiful. I think it's one of the nicest subdivision Christiansburg has to offer, with all the walking trails and everything like that. But in doing so, what Mr. Hagan decided was we kept the 100-foot strip in Shaw Development. The rest of the subdivision was developed under a separate LLC, Cambria Crossing LLC. The reason being that if VDOT ever come back to negotiate the acquisition of that right-of-way, they would be negotiating with a single entity and not multiple homeowners. So we were really in hopes that this road would come. At the time, we actually designed the subdivision to have one point that could actually connect to this roadway. They said there would be a connection, of course, at Peppers Ferry, a connection at North Franklin, one in between at Cambria, or at Cambria Street, and then one more point. So we designed the subdivision to intersect that. Well, here today, as far as I'm concerned, there's still, I guess it's on the 7-year plan, or I'm not sure what the status of it. It sounds like funding may be an issue.
It's one of our highest priorities, but it'll be a while.
Right, right. So when Mr. Helms approached us, like I said, it's almost 2 years ago, Mr. Hagan said, you know, would we want to, would the town be able to purchase that property? Would Shaw be willing to donate a portion of the property? You know, what could we do? And Barry, correct me if I'm wrong, I think Barry's thoughts was that if he had the strip of land, that may put you up higher on the list if the town had the acquisition, as far as VDOT funding and matching and stuff like that would go. So Mr. Hagan said, you know, let me look into it with everything else. We've still got phase three to go. We had developed and recorded phase one, of course. Phase two, which is probably 60% built out now, and we've actually got plans in for phase three now. So then, then I'm jumping around a little bit. Then Barry come back and says, okay, well, we need an easement for the Huckleberry Trail. Mr. Hagan says, that's great. I'm happy about the trail. It's going to be an asset for the entire community. He said, let's go ahead and do that. And I still haven't forgotten about the strip of land, the 100-foot strip of land. He said, but we're getting closer. And that's where we are today. We've actually, what I'm on the agenda for tonight is a re-subdivision of phase one. It's 30 lots now. We've redesigned that to still continue the townhouses, but it's increased it to 32. That's the only change. We've a net increase of 2 lots. One of the conditions that were imposed on us through the rezoning process was no more than 150. If this plat is approved tonight, that would put us at a total of 126 lots and we'll be done. We're not going to get near the 150 with the dedication. But what we are here tonight, I'd like to pass out, this is not a plat. We have an actual plat. This is just kind of a conceptual drawing.
Better idea what I'm talking about.
Parcel A is shown on this conceptual drawing is actually phase three that the town staff have under review right now. It's 30 additional single family lots. Parcel C to the north of Rudibus Drive, that is also part of the 30 lots as phase three. And parcel B is the area of the 100-foot right-of-way that Mr. Hagan and Mr. Sheeler have graciously decided to donate to the town of Christiansburg this evening. We were in hopes that this property would allow Christiansburg a better shot of the funding of the connector and everything else should it be. You'll see the existing 30-foot trail easement to the left of parcel B. That easement was already dedicated by Shaw Development and Cambria Crossing LLC back in November of 2012. So I guess what I'm saying is, very proud to be a part of an organization that looks for better ways to help not only our neighbors in Cambria Crossing, but the community as a whole. We have the road cones, and I think that's it.
Well, thank you, Mr. Rutledge.
Thank you.
I cannot help but ask you to identify Mr. Hagan. He doesn't want to be introduced, I know. But we're pleased to have David Hagan with us this evening.
Yeah, we would like to do this dedication this calendar year, if at all possible. I'm not sure what the actual process is between the board and accepting the donation. But if there's any action that could be taken on that, we would appreciate it.
And that's for tax purposes, I suppose.
Can I make a comment?
Yes.
I would like to personally thank Mr. Hagan for his significant contributions to our community outside of this development. But with this development and helping us with Huckleberry Trail, and now with this donation, in my way of thinking, you're creating a legacy for yourself here that's far beyond your own self-interest. And I appreciate that, and I'm gonna offer a round of applause. If anyone else joins, that's fine, but I appreciate it.
That connector road has been on our books for a long time. And we've had drawings of it. We've had access, ingress, changed the termination of it several times. But VDOT has not put it in their six-year plan yet. And this may give us a leg up as far as negotiation with VDOT to get that project moved forward.
I hope so. Do y'all make your wish list to VDOT and then they add it to their six-year plan? Is that the process?
We have it on our six-year plan, and Mr. Helms is correct in saying we do not have money to build that road right now. That is a very high priority, but we didn't have $14.1 million to build phase two of Route 114 3 years ago either.
Right.
So once we start to create the momentum for this, and have projects that's ready to go, which we're talking about internally to the town, every step of progress here creates more momentum for this thing to happen. But we do not have the money today, but we did not have $14.1 million to build phase two of 114 3 years ago. And having a project that's ready to go and has a lot of support is very instrumental in that. So this is a very important part, is to have right-of-way cleared for this project. So that's how we're...
Just for your information, at our last meeting, we passed a resolution to send to VDOT. And what it did, it listed four items on it in order of priority. Number one was completion of 114, which is in the process of doing. So we feel very comfortable about that. Number two is a study to take place of the intersection on Franklin Street from Cambridge Street down to Independence, which needs to be done because there's some dangerous situations there. And number three and four was breaking up the connector trail, or the connector road, into two segments, thinking that, you know, we broke it up into two segments because we may be able to get one segment started, and then that'll bring the incentive to get the other segment. So we did that at our last meeting, and that's been forwarded to the state.
And this will be good news for the
expeditiously.
Our local metropolitan planning organization, they have in their plans this connector, but they're unable to provide the funding unless VDOT will get on board and include it into the six-year plan. So we think that this will be a real step in the right direction for us, and maybe give us a little leverage. So we appreciate very much your offer of donating that strip of land.
Thank you, Mr.
Hamilton. Is that something we can take action on immediately this evening?
Yes, sir, if you want to.
All right. Let's move on then. Is there anyone else that would like to speak to council on any matter? This is your time to address council on any concern you might have. Seeing no one who wants to speak, we'll move on to item number three, and that's discussion by the mayor and council members. First of all, is a discussion regarding...
Mr. Mayor, if I may, before we, I don't mean to interrupt you, sir, but before we begin, my understanding is if we're going to take action on that, we need to go ahead and amend our agenda now before we get into the discussion by council. And if that's the case, I'd make a motion that we go ahead and amend our agenda to accept the easement as been proffered here tonight, that we accept that and move forward this evening with that plan.
I second it.
Motion to amend the agenda, and we will make that item number four.
And may I ask one other question?
Yes.
Mr. Helms, the first public hearing that we had, we heard this evening by Mr. Dickerson, I believe, and we heard from his neighbors as well. What's the town's position currently in regards to vacating that easement?
We have no need for it as far as a water sewer line.
Thank you very much. Mr. Mayor, I'd make a second amendment to the agenda for this evening that we can move forward and go ahead and give the relief request and we vacate that easement.
All right. Is that something we can do this evening, or are we required to hold it until our next meeting?
That's just internal. That's what we've been doing. It's not required by law.
It's not by, not required. Okay.
I made that motion in regards as well.
Okay, so we have two
motions
to amend the agenda.
Yes, sir.
One is to move forward on the donation of the land by Shaw, and also to take action on council's intention to adopt an ordinance vacating the 10-foot utility easement.
Yes, sir.
And that will be number five. Do you have a second on both of those? All in favor of number four, which is the taking action on the donation of land, you'll please say aye or no. All in favor?
Aye.
And no? And the next item, number five, and that is the vacation of the 10-foot utility easement at Southview Terrace. Discussion?
We're just adding it to the agenda.
We are adding it to the agenda. All in favor of adding it to the agenda, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. So we have items four and five.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Next item is the discussion regarding the appointment of anticipated vacant seat on council. Council met in work session this evening to discuss procedure for filling that vacant seat. And I believe the consensus of council was that we will advertise the position so that any interested party, a member of a resident of Christiansburg and a registered voter in Christiansburg may submit a letter of interest. And we're anticipating that the cutoff date would be December 17th. But included in that advertisement would be a requirement that interested parties would submit a verification of their status as a registered voter in the town of Christiansburg, and that would come through the county registrar's office, and also that they are an official resident of the town of Christiansburg. Did I say that right?
I think so. I think the only thing that we was that it had to be received here by 5 o'clock on the 17th. It could not be postmarked.
And in
the 17th has to be in our hands. The 17th.
It'll all be the advertisement will contain the other requests of council, which is that to be delivered to Mr. Helms in a sealed envelope.
Yep.
And council will not know the names or anything until the 17th.
I will know on the 17th before our next work session. We'll read the number. That's
the number.
Right. Just the number of people who may be interested. I don't think we need to take a vote on that. We had consensus in the work session, and so we will move on to the next item, and that's the reappointment of John Overton to the Montgomery Regional Economic Development Commission. Mr. Overton's term expires on December 13, 2013. I have been in touch with Mr. Overton, and he does want to be considered for the reappointment. And further investigation shows that he is regular in attendance and is a contributing member of that commission.
I thought we were going to come here today.
Yeah, that's what I was.
Well, he's not available.
I move we reappoint Mr. Overton.
I'll second that. Mr. Overton, well, we're not for discussion. I'll second that.
Motion and a second to appoint him to the, or reappoint him to the commission. Discussion?
I'd still like to see if he has reappointed him to make an appearance at our meeting.
He can come here
so we know who he is.
Later time.
I think that's something we've discussed many times, but last time as well, is for any member that we appoint to outside boards and commissions that they at least show their face. Because I'll be honest with you, I've heard some good things about him, but I've never met him. And I don't think it's too much to ask to show up for a few minutes to introduce himself to the people here who take the time to come, and especially the council that appoints him.
I believe this was an item we carried over from the last meeting, correct, to allow the opportunity to, and then did to look at his appearances at the on the board.
Make sure all we can do is make the offer that we'd like to for them to come, but Mr. Overton was not available this evening, so the offer will stand that we'd like for him to come at least.
Can we contact him again, see if he can be here on the 17th?
Well, we can, if that's your choice.
I think we need
I think so, too.
His appointment is up the 13th. I think we need to act on an appointment.
I can act on it, but it's conditional on him. I won't say conditional, but I'd like for him to show up here on the 17th.
We appoint a lot of people or reappoint a lot of folks to different commissions and boards, and it's almost impossible to get folks because of if they are serving on one board, they're probably serving on others as well, and trying to get them to come to a meeting that's held at a particular time that they may not be available.
This has been a thing of contention for months.
That's right.
That we have people that we appoint to various boards and so forth to come and make a presence.
As important as having them before, but, it's not come before us for any formal procedure, but just so we know who they are. But again, it allows the public to know who is in fact representing them on these particular boards. Again, for accountability purposes as well. But I agree with Mr. Van Hoosier. I don't have any problem at all reappointing him this evening, but it'd be nice to be able to at least know who he is.
Was he requested or was he invited?
Invited. But we've talked a lot of times. we've talked a lot on this board for years now that we on this council that we'd like to have the individuals who are requesting to be reappointed that they at least make an appearance, and that way we could they can let us know what their tenure has been like on that particular board, and then again just to be seen.
And we will extend that invitation again. Further discussion? All in favor of the reappointment of Mr. Overton to the Montgomery Regional Economic Development Commission, please say aye.
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 Opposed, no. Thank you. We'll notify Mr. Overton of his reappointment and also extend another invitation for him to come.
Mr. Stipes, if he wanted to come up and say a few words about what he's done and what's changed there, that would go too.
All right, Mr. Stipes, Mr. Van Hoosier, Street Committee.
Okay, the first request of the Street Committee is the referenced Cambria Crossing Phase 1 that Mr. Rutledge presented on a little earlier this evening. Having been on council previously, with this subdivision plat that you see, I guess it's really the last page of this set of plans in front of you, the actual layout, the Street Committee considered its conformance to the planned unit development. Randy, is that the correct terminology? This subdivision plat is in conformance with the planned unit development plat, or the planned unit development plan that council approved several years ago. Mr. Rutledge noted that there was a slight increase in the number of lots here. There would be a decrease in the future lots there. But the most important thing is that the subdivision request is in conformance with their planned unit development. And the Street Committee reviewed this, and it is in conformance with the subdivision ordinance and is consistent with the approved planned unit development previously submitted around 2007. Was it five? But the street committee recommends approval of the plat as presented, and I'll make that recommendation in the form of a motion.
I'll second it.
Have a motion and a second to approve the plat showing the re-subdivision of Cambria Crossing Phase One. Discussion?
You know, the only thing I would say, this is not concerning that, but the middle portion, I think you haven't really started working on that, have you? I mean, at the beginning, you're gonna make it sort of not a playground, but almost a soccer field and things like that. Seems like it needs a little bit more work. Is that still on the?
Actually, it was part of the overall open space.
Oh, yeah.
For the entire development.
Yeah.
We put the gazebos and stuff in there, and we, one of Brad's concerns in '05 was that was actually usable open space, and that's why it was like a 2% or 3% or whatever cross slope. But it's there for whatever the neighbors, the homeowners association chooses.
Oh, the homeowners association is responsible for that?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay.
It's a first class development if you have.
Oh, it is, yeah. I was campaigning through here, and it was. It looks very nice, yeah.
Compared to most, there's a lot of green space.
I remember Mr. Hubbard out there counting cars one Friday afternoon during the rezoning request.
Any further discussion?
But the homeowners, and the homeowners know that they are responsible for that piece of land, is that right? And will you guys be able to help them with any?
Mr. Hagan still has control.
Okay.
The homeowners association until a certain percentage takes over, and then they'll elect their own board and stuff like that. But he has retained architectural review for the entire development, and as well as being over the homeowners association until that percentage kicks in.
It really is. It is a very, very pretty investment in our town. It is a very, very nice development.
It's nice to see all those people out there walking along those sidewalks too.
Yes, it is.
As it develops more.
We need to address the motions on the table.
I'm trying to.
I'm sorry.
We're in the discussion phase. Ms. Clark, will you poll council on this matter?
Yes, sir. Councilman Barber?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier?
Aye. And I believe that's a 6-0 vote. And that is approved. Thank you. We have item B under number 3, and that's Kensington Phase 7, creating 9 lots located on Kensington Way.
Okay, very similar to the previous request, this plat before you is the culmination of the previously approved land unit development for Kensington. This is a phase that has 16 lots, and it has been reviewed for conformance with the land unit development plan, and it conforms with that as well as the subdivision ordinance. And the street committee likewise recommends approval of the subdivision plat for Kensington Phase 7 as presented. And I'll make that recommendation in the form of a motion.
I'll second it.
Motion and a second on the Kensington Phase 7. Discussion?
Just for my own satisfaction, curiosity, is this, these lots R1, R2, R3?
It's a planned unit development.
All right. Well, what's the plan? R1, R2, R3?
It's mixed use one.
It's what?
Mixed use one.
It's a gas station.
Any further discussion? Ms. Clark, I'm going to ask again if you will poll council on this one.
Yes, sir. Councilman Barber?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier?
Aye. And that's a 6-0 vote, and that project is approved. Number four is the donation of land by Shaw Development. You have heard the presentation by Mr. Rutledge. What is your pleasure?
I move we approve the donation with much gratitude.
And that, we need to accept it this year?
Yes.
Yes. But your action tonight, really, you're accepting it.
Has there been a second?
I'll second.
Okay.
Motion and a second to accept the donation of this 100-foot strip. Is that what I understand?
Yeah, containing 3.162 acres.
And the current Huckleberry Trail extension.
Mutual impact. All right, further discussion? Here again, since there's something of value involved here, Ms. Clerk, if you will please poll council.
Yes, sir. Councilman Barber?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Hufford?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier?
Aye.
And that is a 6-0 vote. That is approved with our gratitude and thanks, Mr. Hagan.
Would it be appropriate just to make sure that they get due recognition in the community for doing this and what they do to our community, to sort of have a public dedication of that, that they get them to participate? Would you be willing to participate if we did?
Yeah, we'd be happy to.
Pardon?
Yeah, we'd be happy to.
Okay. I think it'd be nice to do something like that. With the mayor,
you set that up, Mr. Van Hoosier, and we'll participate.
Okay, I'll set it up. Working with you.
I'll work with you.
Okay.
You know, we'll have to pick a time to do it.
This year, right?
Next on the agenda is council's intention to adopt the ordinance vacating the 10-foot public utility easement at Southview Terrace.
I move that we approve the vacation of the 10-foot public utility easement as requested, Mr. Mayor.
I'll second.
Motion and a second to approve. Discussion?
Yeah, I have one question for town manager. And I understand Mr. Hall asked a perfectly appropriate question. Are there any downsides that you see for us to vacate that easement based on our needs for public utility?
For our needs, we don't see any need to put a water sewer line in there.
Right.
The only, I guess, we're just vacating our rights to it.
I understand. No, I understand so, that. But and other than electric, are there any other?
The only other thing is if another utility needed to go through there and there wasn't room behind his building, it'd force them over on the other property owner, but there's an easement back there too. So.
So what it relieves his responsibility or us, or it makes it his building in compliance for us. But he still has to work with Appalachian to resolve any other issues he has.
Just the way I understand it, we don't have any fight or dog in that fight for the AEP easement. They have their own easement from.
So this is just a permit issue at this point with our easement, correct?
Yes.
That's it.
We can do a permit even if there's an easement by somebody else because it's not a public utility easement.
We could, although they could have a civil case against him.
Mm-hmm. And the reason I asked that question, Councilman Hall, is that we don't set a precedent here for vacating an easement that we have an interest in, and I'm satisfied with that.
I think that we discussed that a few meetings ago about our easements, about using those other than utilities.
Correct. Right. Dedicated use easements.
Barry, is it uncommon for the town to give up an easement, public easement, where a utility is? Or have we ever done that in the past?
Well, the ones that I'm aware of, if the utility's there, we have not been vacating them. But lots of times, it's only a public utility easement. They don't have a separate easement. Like a telephone company might be through the public utility easement, but there's not a separate. They can use public utility easement. They don't have an easement themselves. They're using the public utility easement. It's not a Verizon easement. So In the past, we haven't vacated ones that, it was public utilities, and there was easement in it. And I don't remember any, this came up like this, that there was a company, AEP or telephone company had an easement and had a utility in it, and we vacated the public utility part. I don't remember anything like that happening.
And I just got one quick question, somewhat off topic, but AFCO, as far as vacating an easement, when was the last time they vacated any easement that they've had?
I know they have on some redevelopment tracts of land.
Because I'm just trying to look, when I look at this plat, but really development, I should say, what is the future use that they could even be deriving from that, the way it's about something to the property?
The one of their easements is for a primary line to go through. And, you know, if they need more power on the other side, I don't know how it goes from one end to the other, but they said that was a primary, one of the easements was for a primary line, which is, I think, is a bigger line than the normal, you know, just for serving a house.
Sure.
And they said that that's why they want to keep it.
Okay. Mr. Bowley, can I speak one in this?
Yes.
Then, if you could see this, and I'm sorry to interrupt, but in this meeting, and what the town, APCO has done in this thing, my lot is the pink lot. The easement dead ends at this lot here. If you look on this small plat, it stops here. Mr. Butterfield owns a lot. Then Mr. Butterfield owns another lot.
Well, that's what I was kind of asking.
Who's the other lot next to you, next to Mr. Butterfield?
I think you're looking at two different easements, sir. But I think that's a public utility easement. Appalachian has their own easement that goes
but
further,
I think. There's no, the town's easement that they have through there dead ends at the end of my lot. It doesn't proceed on anywhere. And then it ends right here at the back side of this. So essentially, it's a dead, it's no way to even access it from either end of this thing. I mean, I'm sorry to take up your time and feel like I'm trying to push for something, but this thing's a 10-foot that can't even be used.
All we have is a motion to vacate the town's interest in that lot. Further discussion?
Other than that, Mayor, I live in the neighborhood. I haven't heard any complaints about this, and I appreciate the neighbors coming out in support of it.
All right, there's no further discussion. Ms. Clerk, if you will poll council on this matter.
Yes, sir. Councilman Barber?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Huppert?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier?
Aye.
That's a 6-0 vote, and that vacation is approved. Thank you, Mr. Dickerson.
Thank y'all, and I'm going to get out here and leave you alone. Back to Mr. Hagan here. I mean, guys, we deal with David all the time, and if it wasn't for David working with Pathway and the new church down there, the baseball field out at the Bethel School, man, this guy goes all the time, and he's so hard-headed, he won't take any recognition for what he does. It's just an honor to have David here and let him do what he does.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Dixon. And we're aware of that already, but thank you for
He's just a great fellow.
We have a request for a closed meeting under Virginia Code Section 2.2-37111 for discussion concerning a prospective business or an industry or the expansion of an existing business or industry where no previous announcement has been made of the business or industry's interest in locating or expanding its facilities in the community. The closed session is being held for the discussion of Project 2013028 for the Falling Branch Industrial Park. We'll need a motion, please.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. All in favor of going into closed session, please say aye.
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 Opposed, no. Let us take about a 3-minute recess, and we'll have a clear council.
I move to certify that the town council of the town of Christiansburg, meeting in closed meeting, in the best of each member's knowledge, discussed only public business matters lawfully exempt from open meeting requirements by the Virginia law, and only such matters as are identified in the resolution to enter into closed meeting. Is there a second to this?
Second.
Motion and a second. We'll need to do a roll call vote here. Ms. Clerk?
Yes, sir. Councilman Barber?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier?
Aye.
And that's a 6-0 vote. Motion carries. We're out of closed session.
We don't take any action.
Yeah, we're not going to take any action on this. I think Brian has the information that he needs. Mr. Town Manager.
We have the monthly bills. I'll try to answer any questions.
At least one question, Mr. Helms. The when we look through the bills and we see, like for instance, repairs and things, or that would be occurring, say, for instance, use the aquatic center as an example, the like for instance, the building repair of the catwalks. Are those items that are already built into an expense or on the budget for the aquatic center? Are these like emergency type repairs that are just kind of incurred, the money wasn't allocated for?
It can be both.
Okay, and at the end of the year, I mean, as far as what is actually allocated, of course, obviously why our budget numbers differ from our end of the year numbers and all, but this stuff is, where everything is really, allocated appropriately, correct, as far as the aquatic. The reason I'm asking is we see a lot of items in the bills for the choir center, but a lot of large items, especially like the it's like trains always got something going on. So there's a lot of that is this particular year. Have we seen an increase for years past on things that are going on with the choir center repairs? It's like every time we get the bills, there's something going on.
There's a lot of things that are breaking and need to be repaired. The catwalk thing is over the duct work. In order to change the filters, I had to walk on the ducts, and the ducts were caving in, and it wasn't safe. And finally, I said, "We just got to build something so that they can get up on there safely." And the ducts, the insulation is broken on the ducts, so it's been more inefficient. So there's things like that happen. There's pumps; they're rebuilding pumps, and Train has so far their service contracts.
Yes,
and some of it is things or repairs are outside of the service contract.
We don't see the things that are covered under warranty now, but are there a significant amount of things that are covered under warranty still with the aquatic center?
No, not much.
Not much. Thank you very much.
I think that's why we allocated, what, $200,000 in a reserve fund for aquatic center repairs or major repairs. So
maybe that $100,000 per year we set aside. Yeah. I thought we were looking at that for the major refurbishments in probably 7 to 10 years.
That's, yeah, because it will be. Mm-hmm. A draining and a refurbishment.
Any further discussion on the bills?
I have three little comments. All these things are from page one. And the one thing is the Caldwell Corporation, $10,000 on fixing the Huckleberry Bridge. And I want to say that I was on that bridge, I don't know, 10 days ago, 2 weeks ago. And to me, it's a major improvement. And it looks a lot better, and they did a good, real good job. the second thing I have is I see here the Smartway bus, and was a quarterly amount of about $3,000. And you probably don't know yet, but have they given us any indication if fees are going to go up for next year?
Not to
your knowledge. Okay. All right. And the last thing was, I see that we paid $26,000 for fuel from Fleet One, and I think it was mostly for the police force. And I don't know.
That's for almost all of town.
All town, okay.
That's Wilco Hess.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I don't know. And this is just. I went by a police car the other day and. I don't think there's anybody in there, and the motor was running. And, you know, I know that they try to do it so they can take off quickly and stuff like that. But I just, maybe we can pass that on, that I think it's important that they, people on the force realize that we are burning gas. And that's all I have, Mr. Mayor.
Move we approve the bills.
One second. Have a motion and a second to pay the bills. Further discussion? If not, all in favor of paying the bills for this month, please say aye.
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 Opposed, no. Mr. Helms, Ms. Kirby, and Ms. Ms. Tweedy, pay the bills.
Huckleberry Trail update. Don't have a written one prepared, but the only major change is from last month is the portion along Cambridge Street is ready for paving. Hopefully, it'll warm up one day this week, warm enough, and the plant will open. And they've already talked to the plant.
Thursday.
It looks like Thursday's a good day, and next week's not.
Had a request from the Parks and Recreation Department to be able to post no parking signs along Main Street during the Christmas parade. They put cones out. People just come up and move the cones and pull on. And it's forcing the people to stand between cars, and they have a rough time watching, especially kids and all, if they're standing between a car coming out in front of the floats and all. And they ask if it'd be okay to do that this year. They put the signs up. I don't know if we'll get up a week ahead of time, but get them up and say no parking Friday evening or from 5 till 8 or something like that, and try to reduce the number of people parked on Main Street during the parade.
Is that from this building up to the corner where you turn, go to Radford?
They're going to stage on part of the East Main Street here, so it'll be mostly West Main Street.
Okay.
Can we not block it off like we've done in the past at 4 o'clock in the afternoon?
Well, people bring their cars and not park them, and then leave, and then come back during the parade. My only hesitation is that some of those people might be handicapped, and they're just pulling up parking so they can watch the parade from a car, or elderly maybe, where they won't stay in where it's warm. That'd be my only reservation. Rec department's worried about safety of kids and stuff, so they sort of jump out from the cars to see who's coming and that kind of stuff.
Safety trumps it all.
Yeah.
What is the date on that, on the parade?
13th.
The 13th, okay.
Next Friday night.
Right.
Do you need like a general consensus from council? Because I think that's number one, it came from our director. Number two, it makes perfect sense.
If we've been doing it every year, then let's continue to do it, but let's enforce it this time.
We haven't been doing
We didn't have signs up. You really can't force cones sitting there. Right. Yeah. Have signs up saying no parking.
I would think if Barry and the staff can figure out a way to do it, I'd support it.
Yes.
They're looking at ways to have a rope type, some kind of a barrier to be able to put up and take down for each parade, but it'll take a while to research and find ways to do it without being very expensive.
Can we get our big blinking signs in use for a couple hours? Or
they'll probably have those up for detours, because you got detour Main Street.
Mm-hmm. All right. I would suggest that we tell the rec department to go ahead and put those signs up there. I don't know how it's going to be enforced.
I think we probably need to get some website time or Facebook time or a sign prior to within a week of whatever we can get it up. We need to get something up indicating, letting people know that there will be no parking.
That's where you might be able to use those message signs for just a few days, and then you can move them to where your detours are.
Okay, we'll look.
We usually have a bus, one of our short buses, for council members and family to ride in the parade. Anyone interested in doing that again? You don't get to see much until you get out. So, all right, I won't pursue that then. If you want to be in the parade, though, you're free to walk, hike it, stand on the corner, wave as people go by. Anything else, Mr. Helms?
We've had a request to reduce the time limit for parking on West Main Street from 3 hours to 30 minutes. I recommend maybe turning over Central Business committee to look at.
Which particular spots, Mr. Hatton?
Basically from Square down to here. A lot of courthouse parking goes on, and people come in and park almost all morning. They leave, and then someone fills their space all afternoon. It's the flower shop across the street that their customers can't get in.
I park in front of the, next to the Simmons Law Firm. I park in that 2 hours all the time. And of course, the other lot over here fills up quite a bit. And then apparently, I don't know if it's unfortunate or not, but there were people parking along. It used to be, is it still not Scuba Shop anymore? It used to be a Scuba Shop there on the corner. And they had a lot of the troopers, a lot of the deputies.
That's owned by the county.
Okay.
And they've lined off spaces there.
Yeah, they put it there, and then behind there as well.
The parking garage isn't used at all, the upper deck.
Nah.
Who did the downtown parking? Who, was it street committee who looked at that and made a recommendation?
Yes.
Was it?
That was years ago. That was 4 or 5 years ago.
I mean, Central Business will look at it, but I mean, me personally, I would like to, I know the county's not interested in it. I know I've driven through town, and our lot is used by attorneys and law enforcement agencies and board, just people doing business at the courthouse. I've seen a lot of people coming in and out. I can't speak for the employees or not, but
Tuesdays,
I see it.
Tuesdays and Thursdays, when you leave for lunch, you may come back and grab a spot, and you may not. We know what days it is.
But I'd be happy to look at Central Business, but
I have a feeling it may have more teeth, more oomph to it if the street committee looks into it and makes a recommendation.
But
not that the Central Business Committee can't do it.
It was a street committee that's sort of been formally discussed, perhaps
right.
The Central Business
Well, I'd like to
put like something that you want.
Well, one thing that I think it's been mentioned to us, Steve, is public parking signs. And I think we're going to communicate with the county on us putting up signs directing people where to park for public parking.
Yeah.
We had one before they started working on the courthouse.
Yeah.
And as soon as, when they take that down, we'll put one back up there, or when they finish the construction. But
we have a big sign out there, right, for town?
Oh, yeah.
And
town use.
Yeah, they read it as they're going over to the courthouse.
Well, I'm telling you, I just passed through, you know, it's 10 seconds, and you can, no offense, court. I mean, my brother's a judge and a lawyer, but you can tell the attorneys are walking. You got a certain gait to you.
I'm parked on the road. That's your public park. Not to say I don't want to upon the.
Well, Barry, it's Angles Florist is the one that's really. Can't you put, they have some signs over there, you know, parking only for customers only? Does that work?
You don't.
No, public street.
It's hard to enforce it because they don't know whose customers are.
Do we have a traffic enforcement officer?
Yes.
That could do that?
We have a parking officer now.
So that we could start marking the tires at 30 minutes?
I'll tell you.
She does it twice a day now. She does it early, you know, 9 o'clock or so, and then comes back at 11.
Yeah, but she can't go. She won't be able to make the whole circuit in 30 minutes. There's no way.
Not every 30 minutes.
I mean, maybe every hour and 15, an hour and 30 would be maybe pushing it.
But there's no need to make it 30 right now because what is
3 hours. Yeah.
Hour. 2 hours, I think it's 2 hours.
Three.
Two or three.
It's three, I think. But yeah, let us take a look at it. And maybe we have to suggest somebody use the parking that was built for the courthouse.
Who did the recommendation on the Christmas store parking? Because that came to our attention. Was that street committee?
No, it was just...
That was the barber shop.
Right,
yeah. Have we reached out to them
just
about volunteers helping our officers?
Chief, I talked to him. He said that they were working with them, and I'll hit him up again tomorrow and make sure that
it's coming up, isn't it?
Yeah, I think the there's a
Christmas store is the 10th or the 14th.
Yeah, there's an open house, but on the 8th.
It's on the
8th. 1 to 4.
Yeah.
For us to come in and see what's going on.
All right, street committee, that's your baby, but be willing to listen to any input from the Central Business Committee. If you have suggestions.
Their suggestion is
going to
be getting right.
Steve comes to. Uh-huh. Steve, what do you think? You want to?
Unless you want to have a joint meeting. I think just input would be helpful. What else, Mr. Helms?
Sent an email to Mr. Barber earlier today, and I just now noticed that this passenger rail committee, first meeting's Friday the 13th, so Friday the 13th. How we want to handle picking someone to go to that. Mayor Ballinger, you said Mayor Barber might want to do that since it's ongoing. Mayor-elect Barber. But we probably need to do something so we'll know who's going to that.
I will plan on attending that meeting. And they had asked for you to come. Is that something you can get loose? Can Randy come? One of the other of you two, I would suggest. And it's 8 o'clock in the boardroom at Stellar One Bank on Arbor Drive. Okay.
Will your crown be ready by then?
I've got a ring here. I've got a ring that, you know, that's kissable.
The signals on Route 114 are going to be started on Thursday. The new ones at the Walmart entrance and the upper one at the mall entrance. The existing signal lights will be turned off. So they're flashing now to give people a little bit of warning if something's coming.
I'll ask you, going through there with 114, to where the sidewalk is now, where basically it starts about where the county line is and comes forward, eventually it is actually going to be connected completely all the way into where you could walk all the way on the sidewalk from there to play against Sports, the mall.
All the way to North Franklin.
So I was thinking. I think it looks really nice out there. It's pretty nice. They're actually a lot further along once that one side was completed. I didn't realize how close they were really getting, but it's looks very, very nice.
Started on Stormwater Pond next to Food Line, which will eventually, the dam of that will be for the Huckleberry Trail to help connect up to the high school. So Branch started on that, grading out. So, and that's one of the first steps to working on the park down below Independence, the natural stream restoration. So that project has started. And the last thing, do y'all want to set a time for the work session for the next meeting for to talk about?
6 o'clock on the 17th.
Yes. Do we need to make a formal motion, Mr. Hamilton?
I think you probably should.
Yes, sir. Let's make a motion to that effect.
It would move 6 o'clock on the 17th.
Second to that.
Motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
That's on selection committee for the vacant position, or selection procedure for the vacant position.
So it'll be an hour after closing time, right?
Yep.
Perfect.
You can give them time to count the number.
Can you count it?
I hope.
You got your calculator?
Why, you eat a sandwich?
Might have some grease spots on it, but that's all I have.
All right. Anything else to come before council?
Very quick, Mr. Mayor, one thing. I want to mention to everyone on council, let me ask some questions, Mr. Helms. Who do we use to write our grants or to review the opportunity for grants here in the town?
It depends on the grant. The police department has a couple of people works on, the call works on.
It would be for instance, the farmer's market. Who would be responsible for that, the point person?
For what?
The farmer's market.
Probably planning or we get the PDC possibly involved.
The reason I bring that up is, and I think I may have brought this up before, but in going through the last about 8 to 10 years, from the, my goodness, I forgot the acronyms now, but there's two or three different opportunities for grants, and they're non-matching grants. And the amount that was given, for instance, to the town of Galax, was $75,000, which they were able to do everything with, and then some. Wow. And it was non-matching. They had millions that were set aside that were given. This last time, was September of 2011 when it closed. The way the cycle has been running, it appears that, frankly, this is going to start back up again early part of next year. It's just a matter of we can monitor it to know when it comes available. The reason why I brought it up today is the process is, there's also ways to get, there's add-ons for like SNAP, if you're going to take SNAP cards, there's all kinds of things you can do. But if we were able to designate an area in which we think we may be willing to utilize for that, it wouldn't require a lot. And I've got things in my mind I would think about, but it allows us, as far as the grant process, when it does come available, if we can, you don't have to, frankly say, well, this land will definitely be designated, but if we can locate particular plots, it makes it more advantageous for us when we write the grant. The grants seem to be open for a period of about 4 to 6 months when they come open. The lowest I've seen was 50,000 max, so the highest I've seen was a 75,000 max when they do come open. And I just, again, I want to bring it to the attention of council. I think we may have missed it a couple of years ago, and I didn't realize that there was that much out there. There was a ton, millions and millions they gave all over the country, and many, many were right here in the Commonwealth of Virginia. I went to Withillion today and saw how pretty there was, just on what, maybe a third of an acre, maybe a half an acre. It's not much. Galax is small, but it's very nicely done. Salem is very nicely done. And there's no reason why we couldn't have something like that. I talked to Mr. Barber before about having, if we were able to get that far, is to be able to join it in with the Crisper High School with some of their, I don't know what you put class, but be their building trades classes, where they could have some of the kids come over and actually help us, and we could have, I was thinking of some of our community partners, Lowe's and Home Depot. We could get a lot going in this, and we could put this and build this into our grant, our request for funds. But I just want to bring it to y'all's attention. My personal view of it is I would love to have about an acre worth of the land as you come into the old Christianburg Middle School. There's the fenced-in corner there on the right side. It's right across from the court service unit. It's already got the parking right across the street, right across the little way there. It's off-street parking. And just something for food for thought that maybe in the future we could approach. Of course, school board owns that property, but that's not going to be utilized as a school anymore. It's just going to be a backup. And that's 27 acres of property, which would be nice to have 3/4 of 1 acre in that corner. Be all we would need. It'd be accessible to downtown. It'd be that's a fifth of a mile from downtown, if that. So just want to bring it to your attention, and hopefully we can monitor to see if those grants come available, so we might be able to look at that.
The one grant I think that they've been using, you're required to own the land before you can get the grant.
Okay.
Mayor, just off the top of your head, is there any significant land in the central business district that we have access to?
Like I said, we'll have to own it.
So we don't own anything of significance.
Just other across than our parking lot, or that little green space there.
Is there any way we can use the parking lot as a dual use?
At the next meeting, we can have another closed session. I talked to you about somebody that approached me wanting to sell some land.
And $1 million for acre, right?
But I would hope that one point in the future, if we get to that part where we really want to look at these grants, is that maybe we could...
These are all federal grants.
Yes, they are. Uh-huh. Yes, sir. And they're not, again, the non-matching would be the key. But that maybe that we could be in conjunction with the county and work with them in that regard.
What's... Why don't we add this to our list? That's something we want to at least get rolling, not later, well, sooner rather than later.
I think Mr. Hamilton has a good point. When the grant comes available, we're going to obviously need to have the land allocated if we're going to apply for it. And I don't know how long it's open, but I imagine it's a rolling type of admissions process, if you will. As they come in, they're going to be reviewed.
So. I can't speak for anything else, but I know we do own where the parking lot is. Mm-hmm. Farmers markets are typically on Saturday when the town doesn't have official business going on.
I just look at these other ones in these towns and these little areas that I'm surprised we don't have a permanent one. I really am.
That's what I'm saying.
It'd be nice to have one, but not that would be, we could use it on this particular time. I'm talking about actual permanent structure, permanent land dedicated for our farmers market. Again, a half an acre is about all I've seen. The biggest ones, and you can do it 12 months a year. Obviously for your vegetables and things. But then you have your Christmas and at Christmas time, you have your arts and crafts. It's just
right.
To me, I think
it's like Nair's.
Yeah,
like you say, Galax.
Mm-hmm. Floyd, look at Floyd. Yeah, that's
Floyd.
Perfect.
You're right.
That's a perfect.
Abington, just most of them around have something.
Two
and generally, it's one of those situations like the Floyd
and
now.
They have
Floyd like Lane. Timber Trust or something or other.
On Friday
night. They donated
Floyd,
and
the
material.
Have part or something.
And they got to put together.
That's the biggest key. Is we don't really need.
We have a big parking lot at the rec center.
Mm-hmm.
It might be utilized for something like that during the summer months. But we don't really have any land other than what we've got on 114. And... there was a successful vendor out there until he had to move because of the construction. Put it on that property that we just bought.
We do own a piece on Scattergood, but it's not the ideal location, I think, for fire and water, 'cause it's not right on the.
I really think.
I think this call hazard is something we need to look at. You may even be able to, you may already have it, sort of a boilerplate grant request, and then you find the piece of property somewhere, you plug some things in, go.
That little part, the portion on the corner there, there's a chain link fence that kind of goes around it, but if that chain link fence was removed, you already have a sidewalk there as well.
Yeah.
I mean, it really is, and it's probably because it is in the weekend, like Mr. Showalter stated, it's not gonna ever interfere with the school situation, anyway, they would just, we could work out maybe allocating .68, I'd say, at a minimum. That's all we need.
How about we take this, leave it to staff to think about maybe some areas, and we approach this January in a work session, and hey, we wanna aggressively approach some.
Well, I just wanna throw out there for council.
I mean, I wish we owned the property so we could move on with it, but.
Especially if it's.
All right, we'll leave it up to staff to think about. In the meantime, let's all be thinking about some properties we may latch on to somewhere around town. There may be something we're just overlooking.
The swearing in ceremony, 7:30?
Well, it'll be between 7 and 7:30. Try to do it before council session begins.
Okay.
But Erica will be here, and invite your families to come.
Well, I mean, that's the problem, some of them need to know when, now I can't say. I get people coming from out of town, someone from 7, 7:30, I'd like to set it, just have a part of the meeting. First part of the meeting, 7:30.
Well, we've got several items on the agenda that night, public hearings.
But it'd be, I think we have a work session, and they may have a street committee meeting before that, Mr. Mayor, we may have to go to 7:30.
We may have to. All right, that swearing in ceremony came at your suggestion, so.
So you're gonna do it to get the, and we're gonna try to do the swearing in then probably right at the top of the show.
Right.
7:30.
7:30.
If we get it started earlier, we will.
Yep.
And Mayor, I have one thing too here. Everybody, I think everybody has seen the lights here in downtown Christiansburg, and Barry, I think we, you need to send that down. Well, I mean, it looks great this year, and I think it looked better than normal. And done some extensive things right there, and it really, really looks good, and I know all of us appreciate it.
Except the New River Cares tree, it doesn't have many lights now.
I think they add lights as people make donations.
Oh, do they?
Do what now?
I think they add lights as they get more donations, don't they?
Oh, holding that over our heads? I was thinking, Barry, if we could donate some lights to Walmart.
Well, we have been, I mean, providing, we've decorated too, but I think they turn on lights. The more donation you get, the more lights they turn on, I believe. I can check on that.
Yeah, there'll be fundraiser next week, I believe, over at the, in Virginia Tech, I recall.
No further business? We're adjourned.
All